We do have a wonderful session coming up, a session of tremendous interest here when we're looking at regions around the world to make sure that the money that's out there, the pool of liquidity that is available for investment in the renewable sector, that it goes to the right home. And one of the areas, of course, that people have been looking at very, very closely, of course, has been Africa, an area that is making tremendous progress, and of course, in different pockets of Africa too. So we're going to actually have a panel discussion on that in just a few minutes, but just before we actually get started on the panel discussion, we're going to have a presentation from the International Finance Corporation. So just before we get started, I'll wait and call my panel after we've heard the presentation. So please give a very warm welcome, then we will get our panel underway from the Principal Investment Officer of the IFC, Jamie Ferguson. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. I've told I've got strictly 10 minutes to tell you about Scaling Solar, which is a new program from the World Bank Group designed to increase the flow of bankable projects in sub-Saharan Africa and other emerging markets. It's worth having a quick thought on, before we start, on why is solar PV interesting in Africa? A lot of these small, relatively fragile grids, actually the peak load is very much in the evening to get the lights on. So solar PV can't address much of that. It's always going to be a small piece of the mix. So what is it bringing? Well, it's bringing speed. Speed to build in environments of urgent need, which can substitute expensive diesel or can keep water in dams for the nighttime peak. And it can offer low fixed prices for 25 years to a region that's been blighted by oil price volatility. So that's the real value within the energy mix PV can bring, and if it's not doing that, then it's not helping the problem. So before I jump into Scaling Solar, have I got a thingy here? Thank you. Does this work? There we go. A brief word about IFC in sub-Saharan Africa. For those of you that don't know us, we're the private sector arm of the World Bank. We're an investor and an advisor. Our power program in Africa has been growing steadily. Up in the top left, you can see light blue is the megawatts financed, and the dark blue is our capital committed, just under $1 billion in the last couple of years. Our main hubs, east, west, and south, Dakar, Nairobi, Dakar, and Johannesburg. And our real focus is on driving first of kinds. Where there's new challenges to be faced, that's where you'll find us. The first three IPPs in Senegal, first IPP in Côte d'Ivoire, first IPP in Togo, and on the list goes. With that, Scaling Solar. So let's remember why solar PV can be useful and interesting in Africa. Well, on the left, we've got the status quo, which is not delivering those things, neither speed nor low tariffs. And that's because historically, power projects in Africa, private power projects, have been directly negotiated, so there's no competition. The getting to bankable is incredibly difficult when your off-taker is typically challenged from a credit perspective, and so these are bespoke, heavily negotiated contracts, PPAs, and government support that takes, you imagine, 3 to 5 years when you can build a solar plant in 3 months. It's really challenging. And limited public capacity within governments to negotiate those. And often a lot of these grids are small, so they don't justify big projects, which doesn't attract big capital. And of course, that high perceived risk. And as we know, the drivers of solar economics, cost of capital is a key one. In contrast, when it's done right, where you get competition, you get scale, you get repetition. The bottom right-hand side is the graph we all know well from South Africa as a highlighted differential to the rest of the continent, where over the course of four bid rounds in PV, they got price drops of 76%. And the key there is the competition, the scale and the repetition, and importantly, documents that are fair and reasonable and bankable from the start and don't need negotiation. Negotiation is the sort of the black hole of the timeline that you need to avoid getting into. But that's really tough in countries with no IPP precedent and such tricky credit counterparts. So what is Scaling Solar as a solution to drive more projects into the system? And in the simplest terms, Scaling Solar is tender in a box. It's a templated professional tender for governments that want to roll one out quickly and might not have the capacity to do one themselves. And, you know, on the face of that, project preparation, bid preparation, tender process and award, financial close, that's all standard stages of a tender. So what's different about it? Well, it's a one-stop shop in that we think by having a templated product that's ready to go with financing behind it, we can go from engagement by a government to operation of that power plant within 2 years, which may not sound fast in other contexts, but in a context of countries with no IPP track record, that's incredibly fast. And 2 years, essentially, because this is an interesting tool, but at its core, it's a tool, and it needs a willing and committed sovereign who wants to make it happen. And essentially, 2 years is within a political cycle. So that's pretty attractive to politicians who want to actually not show an MOU or a handshake or a ribbon cutting, but actually show power being generated. So what is new? What's different about scaling solar versus just any other tender service or advice that you might get? The first thing is speed and efficiency. The whole thing is pre-templated from the RFQ to the RFP, and importantly, that power purchase agreement and government support. That means that all that's needs to be done is versioning them, tailoring them for the particular context, not starting from scratch. And importantly, the PPA is a balanced and fair one where, through a lot of negotiation, through different arms of the World Bank Group and a lot of third-party approvals, we've effectively made sure that IFC as an investor is willing to bank that and can commit to it. The World Bank as an advisor and as a provider of risk guarantees is comfortable that it's fair for the government in advance. And that means, vitally, that you can avoid negotiation, because IFC can attach a term sheet to that process. Doesn't have to be used by the winning bidder, but it gives the government the leverage to say, here's a banker who's willing to finance this, so these documents are non-negotiable. And that really drives the speed of the process. So number one, what's different about it is speed. Number two is risk management. Really, the more you de-risk, all developers and investors in solar projects want is the development cycle, as we know, has plenty of stumbling points. And you're as good as your weakest point until you get to the point where everyone's agreed and you get to financial close and you've addressed the legal issues, the land issues. So the more of those you can de-risk, the lower the cost of capital that can attract it. So part of the process is right-sizing, find the right size of project for the country, placing it in the right place and developing that. So bidders aren't bidding on a concept only. They're bidding on a fully developed project. And then, in addition to financing offers stapled to the tender, we also have other arms of the World Bank Group. MIGA is our political risk insurer, will attach political risk insurance, and where necessary, the World Bank can attach credit guarantees to improve the credit of the counterpart, the utility offtaker. So that drives to the heart of the economics of solar, which is lowering risk gets to lower tariffs. And finally, scale. For those of you in the room who are solar developers, you know this is a huge market, it's growing fast. Most boards are telling their development teams, don't bother turning up to small market. If it's 50 megawatts, we haven't got the time. Go to where there's got the opportunity of 500 megawatts plus. So the chance of this being rolled out in multiple markets means that the developer market, the investor market, the legal market, the financing market, all gets to know this process, all gets to know the tender documents, the risk allocation, and can see this as a virtual larger market, which gives the governments participating a virtual scale of procurement. So where are we busy already? Zambia's our first rollout. It's a successful tender run in 9 months for 70 megawatts across two projects. The two winners, Neon and First Solar, from France and the US, and was one winning consortium. The other winning consortium was Enel of Italy. The lowest tariff recorded was, we were very surprised by it, 6 cents for sub-Saharan Africa was a real record, particularly given that that's a flat tariff. It's not indexed for the life of the PPA. And a larger second round is expected shortly. Senegal is underway. The RFQ has been released, and a short list of 13 bidders has been selected for the RFP stage, and the RFP is expected to come out soon. Ethiopia has sought support for 500 megawatts, probably a round one, somewhat smaller, on the halfway point on that. And Madagascar also has a 40 megawatt project under preparation. Scaling solar is also in active discussion in other emerging markets in this region and in Asia. These are some of the participants under the tenders. As you can see, it's attracted a lot of the big names in the industry, which again, given the first two to actually go out to market, Zambia and Senegal, wouldn't be on most global investors' target lists. And that's the attraction of the potential scale of this program that's brought them in, the de-risking of the projects and the good documentation. These are the results I just mentioned from Zambia. That 6 cents is, if you take it in real terms over the life of the project, because it's not indexed, it's actually somewhere under 5 cents. And this gives you a sense of context in the African sub-Saharan African market. On the vertical scale is tariff, as we all know. For this solar to be sustainable, it needs to be cheap. But also, as I mentioned at the beginning, it's got to be fast, or it's not really making a difference. The value of solar is its speed of installation. And as you can see on the bottom axis, all over the place, previous efforts under feed-in tariffs, under direct negotiations, the orange dots are other countries that haven't even closed yet, so the clock's still ticking. Blue is where they've actually got to financial close, and Zambia you've got as an example of a scaling solar project and its expected timeline. So that's it. It's the obvious benefits to the government are speed and reduced cost. The benefit for developers is opening them up markets, as there's plenty of developers in the room, I'm sure, who are frustrated by potential opportunity, but it's really hard to close those deals. And for donors, in supporting the advisory work, it's a very efficient way to get bang for buck in helping governments drive investment into power. There's a risk that solar is very attractive from a public donor perspective at the moment, and that's I would argue that is a real risk, because public money should be saved for what private capital can't do and help with transmission and other elements. So that's it from me. I'll hand over to the rest of the panel. Thanks for your attention.
Jimmy, thank you so much. And if you just take a seat here, and I'll ask our other panelists to please join us. So a great starting point for us to actually have a look on. I'd like to invite Frank Wouters back to the stage. Frank, the director of EU GCC Clean Energy Network, thank you so much for joining us. Vahad Fortuhi is joining us as well from Access Power, Managing Director of Project Origination. Anthony Igodaro, please, also joining us, the African Renewable Energy Alliance Africa. Thank you so much, the chairman of that alliance. Amit Day is also joining us from Sky Power. He's the Senior Vice President for Finance and Strategy. And Khaled Baleit, the Director of Special Projects, Masdar Clean Energy. So we have a full house on this session. And Anthony, if I may come to you, you saw that report just a few minutes ago, and really looking at that report, if you can just tell us your views on it also, but what do you think is necessary when you look at Africa in terms of the Africa Renewable Energy Alliance? You've watched the progress over the last few years. You know, where is the financial innovation that's really needed to bring projects to fruition?
Well, I think I come at it from this context. We are an organization who exists to accelerate the deployment of renewable energy in Africa. And we offer a platform to advocates and implementers. And the key thing to do is to bring to the notice of governments proof of things, proofs from rapid prototyping right through to accelerated repetition. And I think that the template, which Jamie has just described, certainly are very useful and have and will contribute, I think, quite significantly. And he's already pointed out that they've had a success in Zambia. 9 months, that's incredible. Never heard of that happening that fast.
So you would welcome this template, actually.
Oh, well, excellent, yes. But you think this thing has to be brought to the notice of the stakeholders. You have to influence a large number of people so that it becomes accepted and helped. Now, your question was, where is innovation required. I'd like to suggest in three places still. We need to make this work in countries which have a high rate of depreciation, such as Nigeria, which, for example, has lost one-third of its currency value in 1 year. So there might quite well be some solutions to that already. But we also would suggest that perhaps there's scope for innovative financing, where perhaps assets are financed from abroad and are leased over a period of, say, what it takes, 8 to 10 years within those countries, and then, not necessarily extracted, but essentially the burden is not on the finances of that country. The second area I would say is in terms of the de-risking land acquisition process. Many of the, some of the developers there are experiencing rising costs when they're trying to acquire land. But from the point of view of the country, there is the necessity to find the social impact, because this land perhaps is being used by rice farmers, yes, and you want to displace the land for the use of solar panels, or perhaps to grow sugarcane in order to have an industrial sugar strategy. These are real facts that have come, so there has to be a balance. And there is a precedent from Cape Verde, where to make life easier, and I think this should be added to the take in conjunction with the templates you've got here, the government perhaps can assist in terms of identifying available land and making a judgment in terms of the value of alternative land uses, and have the land set aside or pre-licensed so developers get that cheaper. I think these are the points I need to make here. Those are two key areas where innovation is required. Right.
Amit, adding on to that sort of innovation in financing in terms of what's needed, we look at the risk in the region, we look at the currency risk. Would green bonds be the answer? I mean, is that possible? And will it work?
I don't know if it's the, it's a panacea and an answer for everything, but certainly it would help a long way. You know, we are very keen on green bonds. We think there's a great opportunity there, but right now what we see in Africa is that, you know, green bonds are something that can only be issued by certain countries. It takes a certain amount of credibility to be able to issue green bonds, and that's maybe where the innovation can happen, because it would certainly help a long way if some of the multilateral agencies can assist in that process in providing credit support and so on and so forth to make green bonds more accessible to smaller countries and able to increase the amount of financing available. Because green bonds certainly are coming. They're coming quite quickly. We're seeing much more affinity for green bonds and acceptance for green bonds in the market, and we will soon see a lot of projects being financed solely by green bonds over the coming years. That's our expectation. So green bonds certainly are an area of innovation. There are certain things that need to be done to foster this market, to increase the growth faster than it would otherwise happen.
Frank, when we look at the variety of projects, and we've seen some good projects there from the IFC, and indeed also what we heard there were that there didn't appear to be a lack of projects, there didn't appear to be a lack of money, but then depending on who else you talk to, there is a lack of money and there is a lack of good projects. So who's right here?
Yeah, thank you. That's a good question, because I used to work for IRENA, so we interacted with governments, and yes, and you talk to African ministers, and they always say, well, you know, we have all these brilliant projects, but there is no money. You talk to our friends at the World Bank and the IFC, they say, well, we got this money, but where are the projects? So the mismatch is probably in a number of areas, and I think one is just the probably the quality of the developers. I mean, there's good ones, but there's also a whole range of people that lack the experience to just properly, you know, prepare documents and do the standard stuff that is required for people to tick all the boxes and make it bankable. But I would also like to maybe take a moment, because I've been reading the title of this session now for like five times, Creating Bankable Projects to Secure Financing for Renewable Schemes. I still don't know what it means, but what it shows is we're talking about...
And I've got a different title, Innovative Financing for Renewable Energy Projects. So let's put them both together.
My issue is that we're talking about projects and schemes. And
yes.
I think one of the things that where there is a real... where there is a real vacuum is actually in corporate finance. Part of what works to some extent, and we've seen a great example of the IFC and their scaling solar approach. But what we're seeing is that there is now innovation, real innovation coming. In the field of pay as you go solar, in the field of mini grids, there are some nascent attempts, and there you're not doing a project. Basically, what you're doing is you're building a company. And unfortunately, if you're doing something new in a new market, it's a new product market combination in Africa, nobody will support you. I mean, the IFC and the World Bank and the African Development Bank, all the IFIs, they all know projects and a PPA, and you can standardize that. But who gives both equity and debt to a startup company in a rural area in Africa? I think that is... that there is innovation there, and it happens, and it's working, but the money is a real problem.
Vahad, if you come in here, you're with Access Power, really helping small to medium-sized companies, the early stage projects. I mean, where's your fear when you go into Africa?
Thank you very much. I think that was very important how Jamie in his presentation made a reference to the importance of de-risking
yes.
these projects in order to make them bankable. And Anthony rightfully said that one of the areas is the fact that for example, land is a sensitive issue, and sometimes the local developers don't take the right procedures, and there's social issues that result. And these add to the detriment of the projects. And often, as Frank mentioned, it's because these local developers have no precedence to draw on. Most of these African countries have never developed a utility scale solar wind IPP. And we saw that firsthand, and we felt that there was an important opportunity to help. And what we did was in 2015, we set up a platform, which is called the Access Co-Development Facility, which does exactly that. We go in and we identify early stage, young entrepreneurs that have a great idea for solar or for wind or other renewables, and we hold their hand through the development cycle. We teach them about how to, secure lands using IFC performance standards. We tell them about the importance of understanding tax exposure, how to address grid evacuation, how to handle social and environmental concerns through the entire cycle, so that by the end of it, they have a fully bankable project on their hand, which they could then go to the DFIs, like the World Bank, FMO, and so on, and secure the debt that they need. And this year, this ACF platform is in its third edition. And so far, Anthony made reference to Nigeria. We were able to identify and support a local developer with no experience and help them bring their project from zero to actually getting the PPA signed for a $75 million project. And last year, we also did another project in Madagascar and a wind project in also Nigeria. And every year, we're getting more and more traction, more and more entrepreneurs are coming forward. So we're delighted to have this innovative scheme in place to assist these entrepreneurs in bringing concepts and transforming them into real projects.
I think we are seeing right around Africa, too, the growth of smaller projects. Khaled, I'd like to bring you in here. And when we look, and Masdar has put great investment in many African countries, not right around Africa, and there's quite a few perhaps you need to be, or Africa would like you to be looking at. But we do tend to see more of the smaller scale projects. What would it take, to actually escalate that and maybe see more large scale projects in place?
First of all, I'm really happy to see the level of awareness and the social impact that's taking place in Africa. When we started 5 years ago in Mauritania, where we delivered a 15 megawatt PV plant in Nouakchott, from there we've seen some growth taking place. Now, these IPPs, PPAs taking place recently in Africa, is really a result of that awareness and the importance of the renewables.
Yes.
I mean, having the experience in Egypt, Mauritania, as well as Morocco. I mean, in Egypt, for example, we deliver 30 megawatt PV plants in different parts of Egypt. We delivered as well 7,000 solar home system in Egypt. Recently, 2 weeks ago, we were able to complete 19,437 homes in Morocco. And 2-3 months ago, we finished 16.6 megawatt PV plants scattered in different parts of Mauritania. Now, moving from the small scale to a bigger scale, I mean, it will require a very stringent policy and procedure to be in place. And there should be some creative way of bringing more investment. I mean, if you notice, there are many millions of Africans living not only in the capitals, they are living on in rural places and remote areas. So we wish to see more trends of IPP, PPAs, and different and creative ways of taking that investment from the urban areas to, you know, the remote areas. Access of funds, cash availability, I'm 100% sure that it's always there. It's a matter of how creative in securing that cash and paying back those investors and developers with the right guarantees in place.
So, Jamie, where do we find these bankable projects, and is that, you know, part of the problem?
Thanks. Yes. So, to Frank's point of the, is it the projects or the liquidity? There is definitely liquidity for bankable projects. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of projects, not many bankable projects, and that's the hard bit to get to. And it speaks to Anthony's comment, which is, you know, you need all the stakeholders involved. If you're developing a project in Africa, these are small, fragile grids with fragile economics. And you need to think, you can't think like in other markets where you just think, as long as I'm okay in my little ring fence project, it'll be fine. You need to think for the whole sector. Is this project right for the sector? Can the daytime power be absorbed? Can the intermittent power be absorbed? Is it in the right place in the grid? And can the economics, can the off-taker pay for it? Getting all of those stakeholders committed and addressing all of those issues is what is bankable. It's not just a document. Is it sustainable and is it fair for the long term? And for them, for that, there is always liquidity, both equity and debt. And so that really is the focus of Scaling Solar, is to create more of those bankable projects. I think there are lots of great ways to go about it. And as Mr. Obama would say, we need all of the above. What I would say on Frank is we were excited just before last month. We just committed $15 million, small, to Mobisol, which is one of East Africa's off-grid pay-as-you-go businesses. So there definitely is room for early-stage growth capital in that space. It's a lot more innovation. I suspect there'll be lots of failure as well as success, but it's definitely a growing niche and a big opportunity.
Anthony, I want to come back to you. You know, as Jamie said, that we need all of the above. That's a tall order for a continent like Africa. And it's great to see Masdar doing very successful projects in places like Egypt, Morocco, Mauritania. But, you know, we don't see them in the heart of Nigeria, and we haven't seen them in perhaps some other, you know, big populous countries that really need a lot more renewable services. Where, you know, are we going to find that's, you know, the scaled up funding? I mean, there's so much that needs to be doing that. And your alliance, I mean, what keeps you all awake every night wondering how do we move to the next level? And what country, it's not created equal, so to speak, you know, and we're going to see such a variety of governments, of models, you know, just this whole attitude between different countries. So it's, I would imagine you have quite a tough job.
Well, Africa is exposed to a lot of information from many different areas. It's an exciting place, youthful country. I mean, youthful continent.
And tremendous opportunity. I mean, tremendous. And a great need.
Yes, but the thing you know that's very encouraging is that the pay-as-you-go model is doing very well. Kenya has been showing 30-plus percentage growth. Companies like Mobisol, you just heard about, Off Grid Electric, and others have pioneered this. You know, these are companies which were probably not in existence more than 5 years ago, and now they're coming up. They have, like, growing companies, an insatiable appetite for investment to fund the total delivery system. The person, the people who get the ultimate funding, by the way, the end buyers, and their success depends on management information systems, essentially through the mobile network. So this convergence of the build-out of mobile networks, technology, the declining price of solar, battery storage, and drive from climate change obligations since COP21, COP22, and which will lead to a universal service obligation, all of that is pushing through. And, you know, a few things need to be done, and they're quite easy to do, actually, which is that with the increasing amount of investment you're seeing, you know, utility and also pay-as-you-go, to a lesser extent, mini-grid, there really has to be a component which is driving and supporting capital, capacity development. We've got lots of universities, young people coming out, and really these people need to have practice and opportunity to engage in the installations, the maintenance, the ecosystem of a thing. And the ecosystems, they teach each other using smartphones, etc. So you really don't have a situation where you have experts, like people working for solar companies coming to teach people how to run these ecosystems. It's actually together that they do this and develop new ways of success. And therefore, Kenya, Nigeria, Ghana, Senegal, these are really exciting places where I am seeing lots of European young people, 30 people, actually relocating to those countries to partner with people there, start companies and run them. And that is really without precedent.
So, Vahid, should we just encourage a lot of the smaller players to actually get started, and by then a lot of scale in smaller operations can probably then lead to some kind of consolidation and perhaps bigger projects down the road?
Yeah, absolutely. I think doing it at the grassroots level and encouraging innovative thinking and solutions for the off-grid market is great. But of course, there's equal opportunity in the utility scale sector where you can work with the government off-takers to help them, you know, address some, you know, liquidity issues, bankability issues, project documentation, somewhat like what the Scaling Solar scheme has done, working very closely with the government players to, you know, put everything in a one-stop shop under the, you know, the endorsement of the World Bank and the IFC to attract investors to cater to the large-scale market, because by only addressing the off-grid, you're not necessarily satisfying businesses, you know, homeowners who are connected to the grid and who need electricity just as much as perhaps those living in rural sectors who do not have access to the grid. So there is room for innovation both at the small scale and at the large scale.
I see you want to come back in here, Anthony. Do you, particularly on this point?
Not really, except one point that is important, whatever we do now, to avoid white elephant projects. And there's an increasing risk that that might happen now as climate change funding comes available. And essentially by a white elephant project, you mean a project which a country can literally not afford to fail. And therefore, I would say that Africa really needs to be looking at a cap around about, what, in South Africa, 75 megawatts or 100 megawatts, thereabouts, but not like an 800-watt single site as was done here, which, and this space is fine. It's got, you know, the regulatory systems, got the money, and so it can afford to fail. But for lots of places in Africa, especially with ethnic conflicts and so on, you cannot and should not afford to do massive sites in case there's some kind of problem. You've got to spread it.
And when we look at the role of the development banks and the international institutions, Amit, multilaterals as well, I mean, what should their role and duty be, or should they perhaps, as you might have suggested, offer guarantees and credit enhancement products? I mean, where do you see that their role is?
So, I mean, to be honest, in Africa, they have a very, very important role. I mean, we work around the world, and I'd say the greatest need of their kind of financing is really in Africa. What we see in Africa is that, you know, the development banks really form the basis and the bedrock of the financing for these kinds of projects. They also offer probably the most attractive terms where available, but their capacity is also limited in the sense that there's only so many dollars to go around and so many countries. So the development banks can go so far, but there needs to be more than that, and hence some of their credit enhancement products, and that's why I was referring to green bonds. Maybe if they can come into other areas and be more innovative and more creative, they can actually expand the amount of capital available into the market, which is actually a restricting factor right now. Because once you move away from the development banks in terms of financing any large project, then there are a few commercial banks available, but then the terms and conditions that you get there are not as attractive. So there is a capital constraint in not only are there limited number of bankable projects available in Africa, but there's also a capital constraint that you see that, you know, it's not that easy to get the financing when you want it or as quickly as you want it, even if there's a bankable project. So the role of the DFIs, I think, is really, really important, and if they can expand what they can do, that would be really great as well.
Frank, what do you think in terms of the role then of the local banks? I mean, that's probably another sector in itself that's doing its best to develop. But are they in a position to actually fund a lot of these projects?
Well, in a way they must. And you know, in many places, you know, there is a currency issue. So in that sense, a large part of the local cost, but also even the you know, the IFIs, they typically work through a local bank. And I must say that in certain countries that that I work in, I'm a little bit disappointed in the eagerness and the appetite for the local banks to get involved and to learn. I mean, it's you know, I think it's a growing opportunity. It's certainly something that that local banks should be more involved in, and they're absolutely crucial. But yeah. I do not see like the spark in many places. For example, last year I spent a lot of time, and you know, we were together in Nigeria. You know, the large local Nigerian banks, you have to really pull them into meetings, and it's, you know, they do it, but it's not like something they're very eager to do. It's different in other countries. In South Africa, it's a vibrant banking situation, but in other countries, I just don't understand why they don't see this opportunity.
Anthony, why do you think that is? Why do you think the local banks are not getting more excited when they look at the returns from projects around the world? And this is a very, you know, the return on investment in this industry now, I think, has proven that, you know, it is strong and it is good.
In the case of Nigeria, I think that Nigeria has grown up as it's an oil-producing company, a country. For years and years, it's been used to the high rates of return available in that industry.
So renewables might be a little lower down on their plan of action now.
Yeah, so they're approaching really with some skepticism in the first place. And secondly, I think that there's a deep-seated suspicion of government and government capability. So unless, first of all, they are made aware, and as you're quite correct, they need to be dragged in the first place, but you know, other forms of incentive, which might be more pleasurable to bankers, could do the same job, you know. And you know, you just have to keep at it. And feedback proof that there is a return, the technology is reliable, and that the world is investing more in renewables than it is in fossil fuels, which is a fact. So therefore, and I'm happy that at least a couple of my colleagues here have got projects in Nigeria.
Yes.
You have an access. I think that although you are private companies, it is in everybody's interest for you to feed the information. Are your projects done on time? Are they delivering the electricity you promised? Are they delivering the social benefits you promised? And let everybody know. Our platform is one which can help.
Fahad, I see you want to come in on this one very, very quickly because we've got to start wrapping it up.
Yeah, I think we could be encouraged by what we saw in the Middle East and the GCC. I remember 5 years ago when these projects were being launched, no local or regional bank was willing to touch solar. And the work that was done through the Middle East Solar Association and other entities to show them the bankability of these projects eventually got them on board. And now the regional banks are now some of the biggest financiers of the projects that are now being unveiled in Dubai, in Saudi, and in Abu Dhabi. And I think in Africa, from a developer perspective, the two issues that we see is first, you know, their ability to match the concessional financing rates that we see from the DFIs. For example, you know, they are typically two-digit interest rates versus, you know, mid-single-digit interest rates that developers are able to draw from the banks. And secondly is tenure. You know, for these projects to be able to provide low tariffs to consumers, they need to be able to get long tenure periods on the loans from the banks. And because these banks are typically not convinced about the long-term viability of these projects, they don't offer long tenure. But we see this gradually shifting and stretching. And so I think that from our perspective, we're optimistic that within the next 5 years, you will see major banks from South Africa, from Kenya, and Nigeria playing big roles in the African renewable sector.
And that's a great way to look at it. Khaled, what would it take to get Masdar to expand more in Africa? Every time I talk to your people, there's an expansion process going on somewhere. But Africa would obviously love to see you do more projects there.
I mean, we are so interested to always work in Africa, as you already touched.
Yeah.
Africa has a bunch of opportunities. And to be honest with you, we are speaking with colleagues in Mali, Senegal, in Somalia. However, if I go back a little bit here, it's the right solution. You have to be creative in delivering the right solution. I fully agree with the chairman of African Renewable Energy Alliance, Mr. Anthony. You don't want to go ahead and basically deploy large-scale IPP, PPA models, which I believe is going to be restricted for the main capitals or maybe 100 kilometers away from the main capitals. However, there is a large population of African countries living in the remote areas. So what is the right solution for those people? I mean, one of the solutions which I want to bring here as an example, we had delivered.
I need a quick one.
A quick one is the example of Palau, where we touched with the local bank there. You know, the local bank there basically was very interested in a sort of like a loan program with the homeowners, where most of the company delivered the solar home system to the banks, and the banks signed a loan agreement with the homeowners, where they're going to pay back the investment in 10 years' time. Probably these kind of like a small to medium scale can apply outside the main capitals of the African countries. And honestly, I think there's more opportunities, and there will be much more REs in Africa. And most of the companies are always interested in working and expanding further and further.
Jamie, wrap it up for us, and then we have to go. So having listened to your colleagues here, what do you think is, how encouraged are you?
Look, I'm very encouraged. There's a long way to go. Nirvana involves credit-worthy power sectors, which means that tariffs have to come up, transmission losses have to go down, and generation costs have to come down, and some cheap solar projects will help in that journey. And then capital markets have to be developed in those markets. Having embedded FX risk in power sectors with dollar-based PPAs and local currency-based consumers is a very tough place to be. So long-term, both need to evolve in lockstep, and I think we've got a long way to go, but we're going in the right direction.
Super. Well, gentlemen, I have to leave it there. I want to thank all of you. Thank you so much for your input there. A lot of information our speed info session on what's going to go on in Africa, but it needs to take the fast track, I think, and we're seeing a lot of developments there, but again, a few challenges, but the opportunities, without a doubt, have to be in Africa, and it's very, very encouraging to see that so many people, many of you are working there, and indeed, we're hearing from many of the investors, too, that they look. Long may they continue. Thank you all so much. Thank you, gentlemen. A big hand for all of them.